I took delivery of my Tesla over a year ago in the last week of March. After anxiously awaiting 6 weeks after placing the order online, the car finally came. But before I went through that process, I wanted to familiarize myself with the technology and the driving experience. So I went to Hertz and actually rented both the Model 3 and the Model Y to see what that experience was like. And I have to tell you, I was a little disappointed in the Model 3, all of the Model 3s that I rented when I first got them. The ride was a little stiff and the build quality literally questionable. There were panel gaps that were uneven, either on respective sides or in the same exact side. I didn't like to see that. There was overspray and underspray inside on the hinges, so I felt that Tesla's quality control wasn't there. And then the car suffered from a lot of rattles and squeaks. And even though it was a rental car, I expected a little bit more because it was only a year old and the highest mileage one I had was maybe 24,000 miles. But then I was able to get into a Model Y, and that was a completely different experience. The build quality was significantly better. There were no rattles and squeaks. It was a long range that I had with the large 20-inch rims on there, but I didn't find the ride to be stiff. In fact, I kind of enjoyed it, and it was very sporty. It was more like being in a Porsche Macan or an Audi SQ5, an SUV that was more designed for sport and aggressive driving. So I didn't really have a problem that everybody else had with the ride quality of that. And that really convinced me to start looking into going ahead with a purchase, because I really did enjoy it. And I knew that the Model Y performance was even faster, more responsive, and definitely I wanted to try my hand at that. So I went ahead and in February, I actually put in my order to get this car. And I thought, for that price point, it's excellent value for money. And in this review, you're going to see exactly what that value for money is. I'm going to talk about issues, problems that I've had or not had, the expense of running this vehicle, insuring it, charging it, what it costs for my home charger to be installed, and what it was like after 12,500 miles, the tips that I've picked up along the way that I can pass on to current owners if they don't know it already, or for people who are considering this car, I have tips for you also. And for those who just have big, huge questions about a full EV from Tesla, I can answer many of the questions that you have about that as well. So let's go to part two and you'll see my review. Today, I'm going to let you know what it's like after owning this and driving this car for 12,000 miles. I haven't even owned it for a full year yet, and I've clocked 12,348 miles on this thing. Now, there have been all kinds of worries about what Tesla's build quality is. This particular model was made in March of 2023, so literally it's almost a year old. There are no rattles, no squeaks, no errant noises, no problems whatsoever. Now let's take a look at, let's walk around and take a look at the quality of the paint finish to see how it's held up. After we walk around, I'm going to show you what that looks like on a meter. So the biggest issue you're going to have with these cars is the rims. If you have black rims on any Model Y, so those are the induction rims or these Uber turbines, they are going to get damaged no matter how good of a driver you are. You're going to have to get some type of rim protection. Now, rim case and knockoffs of that particular brand actually make something for just the induction wheels, but you're going to have to go with something like alloy gaiters for the Uber turbines. But if you don't, I'm going to show you a spate of cars that have nothing but curb rash on them. When I took a trip over to Tesla's Westbury Center, where they had a group of used ones, and I'll show you how that looks. But I'm going to dispel certain myths about Teslas right here, right now. These Michelin Pilot Sport All Seasons. Now, I have a meter here, and I'm going to go up into the wheel well, and I'm going to show you. It's all still in the green. Let's go to the back. All still in the green. Now, what's important about this test that I just did with the tread depth is that, number one, this car weighs 4,500 pounds. Number two, these are staggered rims and tires. So the rears are larger than the front. I am unable to rotate my tires. I have not, and on a regular car, you should rotate your tires every 6,000-7,000 miles if you're prudent. I haven't been able to do that because this is a staggered car. Yet, in a performance car like this, my tread depth is still good. And we can do it all the way around, but that's just to show that the myth that these cars punish their tires and are somehow horrible for the environment because they'll run through tires quickly and end up sending used or worn tires to the garbage dump, absolutely untrue. So that's two myths down: build quality and absolutely tire wear. As far as efficiency goes, like I told you, I've driven over 12,000 miles in this car. And of the 12,000 miles, it's only cost me $500 in charging costs. 30 to 35% of that has been supercharging, which is why the cost is even elevated. But I actually took this on the road, several road trips, just to see how it would perform and just to see the best, most efficient way to charge your car on a long trip. And could I take that? Because when I was thinking of taking a trip in any other car, I wasn't limited by range. I could drive 350 miles without thinking of anything until the gas gauge starts to show me yellow and I have to stop. Here, this car doesn't allow me to go further than 240 miles without requiring me to stop. But it doesn't require me to stop for long. It literally just doesn't want me to arrive at my destination with less than 10% battery charge. And I actually like that because some people want to game that so that they only have 5% so they can go longer. But you never know what will happen to you on the road, what will happen when you get to the place where you want to charge. You never know what's going to happen. And this car utilizes energy when it's parked. So 10% is definitely prudent, and I think we should stick to what the boffins at Tesla had come up with that. So definitely don't try and game it. If it says just stop and charge for 5 minutes, do so. So now look, over 12,000 miles, at least 50% of it highway miles,
at a good speed. And look, no stone chips, and this car has not been PPF'd. This car hasn't been ceramic coated. This car is the factory black paint that's on it. And I'm hoping that showing this car to you in twilight will highlight the fact that the paint job is remarkable and it looks really, really good in black. I have to say my primary complaint about Tesla is that this is a very functional part of the car, the frunk. It's capacious and you will use it a lot. And if this were powered, it would add even more functionality to the frunk. And the windshield wipers are still a work in progress. But I did further research into it to determine why these wipers are so sometimey. They're using camera sensors for the rain or precipitation, not any other type of sensor. So I'm sure, again, the boffins at Tesla are going to upgrade that and fix that. And Elon has, in fact, promised us that it's going to be better. But that definitely needs to be addressed. But other than that, it has to be the best car that I have ever owned. Now, my Mercedes and Lexus, much tighter door closing. When you slammed it, it sounded like a vault closing. I really did appreciate that. Sound deadening material in my Lexus RX was exceptional. My Audi, the build quality was strong, but each and every single one of those cars gave me some type of trouble early into ownership. This one, I've had it for 11 months, driven it over 12,000 miles, and fam, I had one service visit, and that service visit came to my house maybe 3 months into owning the car. And literally, it was a sensor, nothing that was debilitating, nothing that stopped me from driving the car, nothing that I felt was, I actually wanted to do a reset myself, pressing the two scroll wheel buttons on the steering wheel, but I did not have to because Tesla contacted me, said they needed to come out, check it out. So for anybody thinking of purchasing a Tesla, particularly a Tesla Model Y, you will not be in error if you choose this. It's functional, it's fast, and it's absolutely safe.
Costco run. And now, let's see what the on-air, over-the-air update has done for my convenience. Hey Siri, open the trunk.
Okay, done. The trunk is now open.
And guys, guys, we have milk here, and I've already utilized all my storage bins here. What am I gonna do? I'll tell you exactly what I'm gonna do. I have this waterproof storage bin right here. I'm gonna drop my milk in there. I'm gonna drop my cargo top on that. Guys, look at them. There you go. And now I've still got all this space left that I haven't touched. So when you and your spouse have a little alone time and you want to hit the links with the seats in place, you can fit two full golf bags and a side chair for afterwards. Full set of golf clubs in each. Drivers in place, two golf clubs,
And in all honesty, I could fit without this cargo cover, I could fit another two with no problem. And now for the college run. I moved my son out of his dorm on the last day of college before graduation, and this car swallowed the entire contents of that apartment with no problem, utilizing all 72.6 cubic feet.
Oh, so this, my 150 mile per hour capable luxury SUV, has just swallowed all the contents of my son's dorm, which we will not be returning to because the man has earned his degree from this place. So,
8 foot balsam fir, fit with no problem. And I got my lovely wife with me, so two people and an 8 foot balsam fir. Let's do this. I've driven fast cars in the past. My first was a Z28, my second was a Porsche Turbo. But this Model Y Performance is undoubtedly the fastest car I've driven. Here, it's lined up against a $200,000 Mercedes-Benz AMG GTR. And it literally leaves it standing still. And in this next clip, we're going against a Porsche Taycan, which is twice its price. And the Porsche poor Taycan cannot hang. It is left in the dust by a five-seater that can carry two baby seats astride. And here it is, going up against the Hellcat, Red Eye. And literally, it puts its power down immediately. I love this car. And from fast to family friendly, this car is ultra safe, protecting its passengers like no other, except for its smaller sibling, the Model 3. This car has passed every test it's been put through, but it has received higher ratings than Volvos, Subarus. In fact, it is at the top of its class in safety rating. The structural architecture of the Model Y makes it strong and safe with energy-absorbing side sills that act like side impact crumple zones. The battery pack is part of the structure and is mounted low in the car and reduces rollover risk, and the metal body structure can withstand many times the car's weight. As you see here with the Model Y versus a pickup truck. And that's what makes this performer the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration's top pick for safety for an SUV.
All right, fam. Now it's time to talk about costs of running this car. Insurance, exactly $2,011 for the year, full coverage, full comprehensive in the New York area. Charging cost, $534. 70% of that is done at my home. I have a home charger that I bought from Tesla for $425. And I had it installed for $1,000. And that was it for me. And then as my ownership progressed, I had learned that, you know, if you charge your car at super off peak, your kilowatt hour charge is really low. And that turns out in my area to be just 6 cents per kilowatt hour. Now, just to give you guys an idea of what that is really like, in total, I've used 3,621 kilowatts of energy. 70% of that 3,600 has come from my house. The other has come from supercharging and free charging. Now, I don't do free charging often, only because I'm only paying 6 cents per kilowatt hour anyway. But if I'm at Amazon Fresh and I can use the Volta DC charging, I'll get, you know, I'm usually in Amazon Fresh for anywhere between 20 minutes and half an hour. Or if I'm returning something, I'll take the opportunity to get a quick charge there. I will use an adapter, which I will show you, hook up to the Volta DC charging and then do it. Or when I'm at the beach, or when I'm in do destination charging, when I actually stay at a hotel, the Hilton chain has actual level 2 charges there, and I'll just plug in overnight. So I've gotten charging from that. So that's the balance. Your AC can be activated in two different ways. Now, I like anchoring my hand behind the screen and hovering over what I want to mess with. So here's the AC. All you have to do is just touch it, and now the AC is on. You no longer have to fiddle with this. You don't have to go back to it and slide it up, although it's quite easy. Literally, you can say, press this scroll wheel button on the right side to activate voice command and say, I'm hot. And it will automatically turn the temperature down 3 degrees. I'm cold. Now, even though it said try again, it absolutely responded and turned it up 3 degrees. Because sometimes when it says try again, it's literally just trying to listen to your cadence and your voice. But the AI in this car is so good that its assumptions are almost correct. Navigate to Costco. It will give me the list of Costco's that are near, and I just touch it and it navigates me directly there. Now you want entertainment. Play WBLS. This is, will take me directly to the radio station that I ask. It'll also play any song, but due to copyright, we won't do that. So no matter what song you ask, as long as the Tesla streaming library has it, and you will have streaming for the first 30 days you own your Model Y and Model 3, I suggest that that's a service that you get. If you pay for it in advance for a year, it may work out to be around $89. As opposed to $10 a month. That gives you this 3D rendering. Let's take this down. That'll give you this 3D satellite rendering. It'll give you streaming service. And it also gives you TuneIn. So let me show you another. So this is your infotainment card. You swipe it up. And now it gives you a more elaborate screen where this is what I played previously. So I'm currently into Tyla, big up South African princess. But this is TuneIn. So TuneIn allows me to get MSNBC. And let me actually show it to you. So TuneIn, these are all of the channels you get with TuneIn. When you're not in navigation to a destination. Your map pulls all the way out to this type of magnification. And it's a really good satellite map with ridiculously good 3D rendering. And in order to get this to not look like that, all you need to do is double tap. It will go. Double tap again. Double tap. Double tap. And that is your highest resolution. And I like using the compass bearing, but you can change that and literally go have true north where you're actually driving in a map. But I'm not too crazy about that. You can give yourself turn by turn, but I like this, the map. And then anytime you touch that, it will bring it back to its default resolution. But again, so in case you didn't know, that's how you do it. All right, fam. So with the new update, now when something is in your blind spot, before that records, you will see a red flash in the corner of your camera screen. And that means that definitely there's a vehicle there in your blind spot. Of course, you can see it there, but it's giving you one extra layer of indication. So there it is. And now, as you see, I'm clear, and it's giving me the all go ahead. So, guys, underneath the armrest, right? Let me take out my removable tray so that you guys can see it better. But here, if you see here, I have an adapter that's going into a cigarette lighter receptacle. Now, we don't have cigarette lighters in our cars, but we do have a cigarette lighter receptacle. And it's right here underneath the armrest. And I need it because I run a Cobra radar detector that powers off of this power adapter right here. And it only goes to, it only goes to a cigarette adapter. So, and I have another here to give me two standard USBs. So guys, right in here, open it up, it's a little flap, pull it to the side, and boom, you've got a cigarette lighter.